What's going on, everyone? I'm Mike.
And I'm Phoenix.
We're the Turntable Teachers, and class is officially back in session. What's going on, my brother? We're back.
Chilling, man. Da-da-ding, da-da-ding, da-da-ding. Class is back, baby. Class is back. Get ready to get schooled, yo.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am really excited for this episode. Of course, last time, if anyone's tuning back in to the podcast, welcome. If you are just joining us now for the first time, obviously follow us at Turntable Teachers on Instagram and make sure you subscribe to our podcast on YouTube and also any streaming service that you get your podcast, Spotify, SoundCloud,
yes,
Apple Music, the whole nine.
You guys all know. Of them.
All,
we're
yeah,
there.
Yeah.
All of them. We're,
all,
there.
We're on all of them. You don't have to subscribe to all of them, but subscribe to the one you use, of course. And of course, if you are just, you know, joining us in for the first time, Phoenix is our co-host. I am the other co-host, and we are going to be back doing some more song reviews. And this time, I'm very excited to do these because, and this is, I guess, kind of the rebranding of this, because we used to do it as Boston Artists Review. So if you're like an old fan of the show and like you've been around for quite a while, you definitely seen these before. We review the local artists and the local music and things like that. I'm going to be a little bit
when
of rebranding.
I came in and I had to bust the door down for everybody from Massachusetts who's not from Boston.
Yes,
okay?
Exactly.
All right.
Yes. So now this is the Massachusetts music review, not Boston. So we're doing just keeping it Massachusetts music, which it kind of was that already. I was just calling it Boston, kind of being ignorant, I guess, because,
of course,
Boston is
the
city of Massachusetts. But yeah, exactly. Like, we have to be more expansive when we talk about music, especially with Massachusetts. So this is the first, I guess, real installment of Massachusetts music review. And if you want to check out some other reviews that Phoenix and I have done, we did a couple weeks ago, I would say, or maybe a month ago, we did a bunch of brand new singles on the national stage as well. So we try to mix it up. And of course, we wanted to get some Massachusetts-based stuff in here. So on this episode, we have 7 tracks. And the episode that we'll be dropping next week will be another 6. So we're definitely going to be keeping this ball rolling as quickly as we can roll these out. And these songs are all from January, the start of this year in 2021, up until about now. So we're calling it like the first quarter of 2021, reviews.
Definitely.
So, I mean, I'm ready to go. I'm excited. We've been doing this, like I said, for quite a while, and I'm ready to go. You ready to jump into our first song?
I'm in. I'm ready, man. Let's do it.
Let's do it. So our first song is a Paper City Studios artist, which Phoenix is also as well, so this will be kind of
shameless plug.
Shameless, exactly. And we got Jonas with Motivation.
Yeah, I'm chasing this dream. It's keeping me up at night. I'm in the studio working, cause I see me a new life. They said that music won't worth it. Hold up, just watch how I take off. I don't want to be famous, but some niggas ain't need motivation.
So this is your boy. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this track, and also, so his role in Paper City Studios as well. Give us a little bit of background on each of these artists as well.
Yeah, for sure. You know what I mean? Like, although there's relationships there, you know I'm going to keep it G. Like, this guy is trash. You feel me? Like, he can't hold a tone. that's all jokes. Paper City, this is my guy. Jonas and Paper City Studios is kind of the studio thing we got in Holyoke. And we're trying to collaborate with as many people in Western Mass as we can. And Jonas is our resident engineer. And he's also, a nasty MC. And in terms of like the role he plays, he kind of wears a bunch of different hats. Like I said, he's an engineer, he's an artist, and aside from that, he's just also kind of part of the brains of what we got going on. You know what I mean? We all contribute, but definitely Jonas has a heavy hand in it. And this Motivation single, it was something that I've actually heard for months, and he kind of recorded, I think, the first time, like, he recorded it when we initially opened the studio, somewhere around that time, I'm pretty sure. And it was kind of sitting in a vault for a while until he was ready to drop. And then he finally dropped. And it got definitely a good reception. And I personally I guess at this point, I'll just start getting into how I feel about the track. I like the track a lot. I think the beat and the musical direction that Jonas chose is like super unique. Because I think anybody, upon first listening to that beat, like I don't think anybody except Jonas could have brought it to that different kind of to this different kind of vibe. The track is called Motivation. I don't know if I stated that already, but the gist of the chorus is too, like, I don't want to be famous, but right. Some niggas out here need motivation, you know what I mean? And I think that's insightful, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? Because I think also it's just difficult, or not difficult, but it's a different relationship with me and Jonas, because I know him personally, and knowing Jonas personally, he's definitely a guy who's invested into this music thing genuinely for his love of music. And I think maybe you're able to get that impression too, but just through the song lyrics, you know what I mean, a lot of it's just talking about, like, you know, I'm staying up late in the studio working, chilling, and I don't even want to be famous, but I want to be motivated. So there's a lot of like, I want this, I want that, but I think the gist of it is like, I just want to do this music thing, because I'm very in love with this music thing. And I don't know, I think that it comes across authentic. I think it, again, the musical direction of it, or just the musicality of it, is unique and at a very high level. I think the vocals are dope, and it's kind of a laid back kind of vibe, along with lyrics that you can still stick to, and I feel like are still sticky and catchy in that way. So I thought it was a really dope track. I think it has a great vibe to it. I definitely run it back. I think everybody should run it back. It's a product of Paper City, but I am biased, of course. So I'm definitely interested in what you thought about it, Mike.
For sure. And just to preface this too, there's going to be other songs on this episode as well that I'm a little more closer with than you are as well. So there's going to be some bias on the other side as well. And then there's some songs here that, you know, artists that we don't know personally, but we know from Massachusetts. So we have that nice mix. I think that's the good part about this list that we have for this upcoming.
And it's only right, as Massachusetts natives ourselves, of course. We like music. We have friends that make music. Some of us make music.
Exactly. And we're just naturally, we're both in the industry and in different ways, of course, but we're both in the music industry in Massachusetts. So, of course, like, you know, there's just going to be relationships that have been had.
Right.
That's just the way it is.
Right.
So that's why it makes these, you know, it makes it great, but also tricky at the same time. So just getting to preface this, like, this is just our opinion, of course, of these songs, like, going forward, like, you know, we encourage you guys to check these out yourself and, you know, obviously drop us a comment. Let us know what you guys think of these tracks. But kind of going back to Jonas and Motivation. So I agree with you with a lot of sentiments you put down, because I actually overall do like this track quite a bit. I love the instrumentation. I think the violins are super beautiful, and I love the mix of like the trap drums and stuff like that. I think he does a nice job of kind of eloquently blending both together with some like a hard hitting trap style track, but also like with these more kind of beautiful, lush, you know, elements of the beat. So I really enjoyed that part of it a ton from him. And I love the message as well. I think it's like, you know, he isn't really focused on, like you said, the fame aspect of it. He wants to just make music because he naturally just enjoys it, and kind of like talking about him finding his own intrinsic motivation and like what you want out of your life, instead of like these external, like, you know, motivations, like, you know, money, girls, cars, whatever it is, right? Like, you know, big house, like that's not really like what he's claiming he's in it for. He's going to continue doing it no matter what, even if that stuff comes or at any point or doesn't, just depends. But, you know, it really, that I think the message of it is really great. And I think it's just good for anybody to hear, whether they're in the music industry or any industry at all. It's like, you have to have a passion for what you're doing. We've talked about that many times on this podcast. So I definitely enjoy that aspect of the song for sure. I think there's like a really cool melodic delivery that has a really awesome vibe just overall. I think you had definitely mentioned that as well. And I think if anybody that's listening to this right now likes like the cross between trap and a little bit of soul, I think they'll definitely enjoy it. Even though he's not really singing on this, it still has sort of a soulful vibe to it.
Definitely. Almost has like a gospel-y vibe a little bit.
A little bit. Like, I think the violins really help with that, or the strings, whatever the sample we use there. And he's a talented dude. Like, I mean, let's just put it this way. Like, he's a jack of all trades. He does a lot of different things, clearly, for you guys. You know, production and mixing, mastering, engineering, and, of course, like, being an artist. So big, big props to him there. The one critique I will have with this track is I feel as though sometimes his vocals are a little bit monotoned for me. That is just, I think, a very minor thing, and it doesn't really take away from the overall my enjoyment of this track, because I have, as well, like you had mentioned, been running it back quite a bit as well. So, you know, overall, I really do enjoy this one. I think it's a really solid song from him. I'm very curious to see where he goes next with his sound. And, you know, I know you guys have a lot in the vault ready to come and come out, and I'm excited for what you guys are doing. I think you guys got a really cool, collective, and we got a few more coming as well from Paper City, or even just the Western Mass scene in general, on this episode, and then, of course, the next one as well. But so we got a nice mix of Western, Eastern, Boston, all that. Yeah. So in terms of what you guys are doing as a whole, like, big props. And Jonas, man, I dig the track. I think it overall is something that I definitely will be listening to the rest of 2021.
Same. And I can totally empathize with kind of what you were saying about the monotone vocals, and which, again, I thought was I think is just also a unique decision to make, because I think anybody else listening to that beat, I think, would have gotten a little bit just a different energy, where he chose to go really laid back.
Very laid back.
I think
back,
it's really,
yeah,
really strong in the chorus, and that's also where the songwriting is really strong. And I can see you wanting a little bit more of variability, or, you know what I mean, or variation in the way that he delivers in some of the other places. So I can totally hear that one for sure.
Yeah, and that's just a personal, not choice, but like a personal, just, you know, opinion of mine.
Preference.
Or thank you. I needed that help.
Gotcha.
Yeah, no, definitely a personal preference of mine, where this beat is so, and this instrumental is so dynamic. I would have just liked a little bit more dynamics in his vocals. But I do agree with you as well, where the vocals in the hook are definitely, that was what captivated me the most about this song, was he had some like high and low runs in that hook as well that I think were super catchy. So that was really more or less what I liked most about his vocal delivery on this track. So I'm glad you brought that up. But yeah, no, overall, I mean, that's a very nitpicky thing. I don't think that it takes away from the overall, that was just his approach to the track, and that's fine. Mm-hmm. Like, that's, I'm not a bash whatsoever. And you know,
no, we're
course,
keeping it G, man. We're keeping it G. We're just being
exactly
honest out here. You know what I mean? And if Jonas got a problem, he could take it up with me. You know, I got you, Mike.
No, it should not take anything away from Jonas. Like, the man, you guys got to support this man. Obviously, the song is linked in the description, so make sure you check it out. And I'm very excited to see what Jonas has coming next. But this is a really good start for him, I think, in 2021.
Definitely. I mean, I guess, honestly, we're talking about a Paper City studio artist. I can just segue on to the next one.
Let's do it.
Because this is another one. This is Ish Akinor?
Akinor.
I'm not going to lie. Yep. Thank you so much, Mike. I'm not going to lie. I struggle with the name. And this is actually a close friend of mine also. But we always just call him Ish in the studio.
You can't
right.
Tell you
but this is
talking.
Ish Akinor with Relapse.
Baby, don't go too far. Come and relax, cause really I'm hooked like drugs. I relax.
And not a Paper City studio artist, but a friend. A friend of the studio, for sure. And another person representing for Western Mass, OD. And he came out with this track, Relapse. A real kind of, you know, Ish is a smooth guy. And he's talking about some smooth shit in this one, too. You know what I mean? So definitely interested on how you felt about that, Mike. Let's go.
So opening track to his latest EP, When Feelings Fade. And so anyone that is, if you enjoy this song, I encourage you to check out the full EP. It's got like four tracks, so it's definitely a digestible and accessible project. And big shout out to DK, who did the production on this track in particular, and I believe the final track as well. So DK, he's a Turntable Teachers alumni. He's been on the show before. Of course, we've been putting on all his stuff for sure. I even wrote a piece for one of his latest singles, Reality. So definitely with Ish Akinor, I love this song, man. Oh my goodness. This is a song to me that really just shows the versatility of an artist like Ish, and really I think the trajectory of where he could potentially go. Like, I love his delivery on this, especially in the hook. I just think he has really great vocal talent in general. Like, he can rap, he does the croon thing very well, and he can even hit some notes as a singer, especially on that hook. And I think just overall, the song, it's smooth. It just has a nice groove to it. Almost has like a Latin music vibe to it as well.
I can hear that. In a sense.
Very much so. So I think DK did a nice job with those really slick guitars, and the strings are super bright. So overall, man, just the aesthetic of it's really great. And then lyrically as well, I love his just dichotomy, or in his, the way he portrays like the interpretation of a relapse. So like usually, like, I think this would signify, like, you know, anyone thinks, like, you know, when you're thinking relapse, you might think of, you know, like a drug addiction or some type of addiction or something that, like, you know, would heighten that dopamine effect for you, whether it's like, you know, drugs, sex, whatever it is, and sort of giving into those feelings. But here it's almost like he's referring to a relapse as like people getting comfortable or like complacent with themselves, like, or with their life, and how you can kind of like relapse into just that complacency. So it's not really as much like about like what you would normally think a relapse is like. But then, of course, he, on the other hand, also mentions, like, in his bars, like, you know, the comfort itself is something that's like safe and easy to fall back to. And then he's kind of conveying it over with this female, and, you know, he's trying to, you know, convince her to take this leap of faith with his lifestyle as well. And I love the line in the hook where he says something along the lines of, you know, while they're stuck in Massachusetts, we'd be skipping states.
Yep.
I really do.
Yep. Like, I was going to say that one too, for sure.
Yeah. And just the way he delivers that bar is really dope. So, yeah, man, I think that this song is a really good representation of him. And I'm really glad that there's an artist like him in Western Mass. I think he's only a matter of time before he really starts to get a lot of attraction and attention. And I know this EP got some pretty good praise out in Massachusetts and even outside of that as well. So out of the 7 tracks we're going to do on this episode, particularly, I think this is probably a favorite of mine, and definitely a highlight for sure.
Cool. Yeah. No. So I got to say it again, Ish Akinor, because I, you know, I'm not here trying to mispronounce anybody's names, and it's not like I'm not trying to put in the effort, because this is definitely my man. So I want to give him the most respect. But Ish is tough, bro. Ish is tough. I definitely love the beat. DK went crazy on the beat.
DK go crazy.
It's funny you say the Latin, right? DK go crazy.
DK go crazy.
It's funny you say the Latin kind of feel. There's like, I couldn't put my finger on as to what it was, but like the beat was just really, really unique. And I think kind of that Latin thing, there's and then also towards the end of the track, kind of just jumping right now towards the end, there's like, it has that little outro. It's like, it sounds like a little dinner party, which I thought added to the whole ambiance perfectly. You know what I mean? Because it was like, it was something that was like, you know, it's like upbeat, kind of sexy, you feel me? Like, but also kind of something that could, and I'm going to say this, and this isn't insult at all, it's like something that can also play in the background, but you can also pay attention to. Like, I don't know.
Good point.
It added,
I think
you know what I mean?
Point.
That's where I
do.
Right. That's what, yeah, I mean, where it's like a real ambiance to it. I loved it a lot. This man goes from rapping and singing back and forth so quickly, so smoothly. Like, it's ridiculous. And
I know.
It's really impressive for sure. And it shows that, like, he, you know, he's got chops for both, I think. Like, whether it's just, you know, whether it's not maybe full out kind of classical singing or whatever, but it's definitely super, super melodic and damn near close to some real professional singing. But the contrast and kind of, like you said, the dichotomy and the duality of him just going from one sound to the other, it's like Ish could high key Ish can make a song featuring Ish and it'll sound like two different people, you know what I mean, if he made that decision. And I think that's definitely, like you said, it was a really good showcase of his versatility as an artist. I like how he added, like, at one of the verses at the end of the second verse, I want to say, or maybe like the first verse, he kind of adds like he added those little ad-libs that are like, oh, fuck, like, blah, blah, blah. Like, oh, you know, almost kind of including, like, what you think would be cut off at the end of a punch, of a punch in, and I think that added some character there, you know, especially when he's like sounding so smooth all the time, kind of having that natural organic little like slip up, or like, I don't even know, maybe it was completely intentional, but it added some character in there. And I don't have like the timestamp as to where it is, but it's at the end of the second verse, I'm pretty sure. It's okay. It's a smooth little ad lib that just, I think, added some like well-needed character that was, I don't know, again, like natural, that felt organic, because he's so crispy and smooth on the beat, bro. Like, sometimes it sounds like, damn, like this might be just some real, it just sounds polished, you know what I mean? Very polished, which is great. And from me knowing Ish personally, he's very, very you know, I guess the way he records is a very tedious kind of intricate process where he's definitely paying attention to the details, and I think that shows here. It was a solid track, and this is probably one of my favorite Ish tracks. And I've heard a lot of them where he goes crazy, and he has a lot in the vault that I've had the pleasure of hearing too, that it goes crazy. And every day I think I hear his I just hear him improve, and especially in terms of his rapping, honestly. I think his pocket, where he sits comfortably and sounds also the most confident, is in that melodic kind of croony, you know, sound. But, you know, the man can rap too, you feel me? Like, the man can put words together, you know? And I think he's getting better and better at it with different kinds of punchlines and different flows and different kind of cadences when he's, like, just rapping. Because he has, I think, a multitude of different kinds of tones when he's singing and being melodic, but I think in his rapping bag, he still has some way to go, but he's clearly like digging for it, and he's showing a lot of improvements along the way really quickly too. So I'm definitely very, very proud of this track. Very, very dope. Shout out to Ish Akhenour.
And this is, I believe, I don't know if it was this song in particular, but one of his songs landed its way onto Gary V's playlist, which is super dope as well.
Yeah, he's had a couple of them, actually. No, he's had a couple of them on Gary V's playlist, yeah.
So Gary V's, when I say, like, he's getting national attention, like, people, like, are starting to come on to the fact that he's a good, and this is the type of artist where, like, you know, I love that he's from Massachusetts, because we can, like, kind of call him our own, you know what I mean? Like, I really enjoy, you know, just overall the song. The EP is fantastic, guys. Definitely go check it out. When Feelings Fade. I think this is one of the better, like, songs I've heard from Massachusetts so far this year. Just kind of, like, if I was to put, like, a, you know, we probably will end up doing this, honestly, like, a, you know, a mid-year sort of list or review or whatever the case. Mm-hmm. I would be stunned if this wasn't there, put it that way.
Yeah, right.
Especially from Massachusetts. But speaking of another Paper City Studios artist, or at least affiliate, if you will, and the man Robbie Malik, who just dropped his debut project, Who Is Robbie Malik? So another one that you guys should totally check out, especially if you like this song. And the song that we're going to review on today's episode is going to be his lead single to this album, which was All My Life.
Yeah, remember when they used to say, I'll never be a star. Now I let it ring, every time they want to call. Don't care what you think, or how you are. This is what it is. I don't care about what it was.
So I guess we'll start this song with you. You know, what are your thoughts on All My Life?
Banger. Banger.
It's a tight song.
You know what I mean? It's not like a banger, like, you know, play this at, like, the club where everybody's trying to, you know, shake it and go crazy. Mm. But it's a banger when you're in the car alone. You know, a banger when you're in the car maybe with a significant other. A banger in the car, maybe when you're missing a significant other. It's a banger in the car when you have no significant other. It's tough, man. And so definitely, it's shout out to Robbie Malik. Definitely go check out Who's Robbie Malik, the album. This, like Mike said, this is the lead single to it. And the project from top to bottom is stacked, man. And Robbie, you know, we were talking about Ish with a polished sound. Robbie's definitely another person in the area in Western Mass that has a very, very polished sound. And Homeboy has only been cultivating it for like a year max. Mm. You know what I mean? He's kind of just been making his debut on the scene in general. And he's already jumped to like a debut album that sounds like very, very professional. I know him. And again, shout out to Jonas. Him and Jonas, you know, worked in tandem to get this thing together, and they definitely put a lot of care into it. And I think every track kind of, every track shows that, and including the All My Life thing, the All My Life banger. Robbie has a real laid back kind of delivery on the track, and it starts off laid back, and I think that really sets the tone also for the rest of the track. Like, especially when you hear his voice really clearly before a lot of the drums come in, and I think it starts off kind of his the storytelling of it, kind of, you know what I mean? Like I said, a lot of it are some smooth kind of flexes about whether it's girls he's had before or women he's still involved with. And then a lot of it is also some like reflective, like, damn, look how, and again, it feels very authentic, just me knowing him personally. He talks about, you know, how his music and just him pursuing this in the past couple months or close to a year has already shifted the world around him. You know what I mean? People are looking at him differently. He has certain friends that maybe he doesn't trust. But it's, all of it is like, all of it is very vivid to me, I think, with Robbie's lyricism, and that's what makes him really, really special. And then aside from that, I think the beat he chose is super fire. It has these little afro kind of dance hall drums, but a real dope laid back, like the SZA sample in the background just sitting in the cut is so fire. And I think like it's perfect because the song doesn't have a feature, but it almost has that feature because I think SZA's voice is obviously very distinguishable. But it's so faint and it's just there for the melody in the back that I think it really helps Robbie shine, but also makes the track more dynamic in the sense that you're hearing somebody else's voice faintly. And I think it, you know, I think it complements Robbie's voice well. I think also Robbie has an amazing ability to kind of have that laid back delivery, you know, and it's kind of similar like we were talking about with Jonas, but I think he has some ability where I think also it's the lyricism itself being so good that it's very vivid and I creates an emotional response, and also just the content of it is you know, backs up the delivery or kind of calls for that delivery. Well, like I don't know if that's the best way to even articulate it, man, but he it's tough, you know what I mean? This song is tough to me. I think it's kind of emotional but also braggadocious a little bit, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's got both of those elements to it.
Yeah. So, and I thought it was I think this is a really good sum up of Robbie's style too, and it was a perfect lead up for Who's Robbie Malik, which is also a great album title, honestly. But yeah, I'm interested in what you thought.
Definitely. So I will say this. I think his voice is very unique, and that is one of the, I think, highlights for him just as an artist, where if I heard his voice, I think would be very recognizable. And our producer, Sam, so shout out Sam, who obviously, as you guys are watching this, listening to this, did all the production work, so big shout out to him. But there's a friend of his who ended up reaching out to him when I featured this song for a New Music Friday. And a friend must have come across the page and, you know, heard the song and hit up Sam and said, yo, this, I found this from Scarfo's, that's my last name if anyone didn't know that, from Scarfo's podcast, like, page, like, this song's a banger. So even people that are unbiased, that don't even know him, are coming out and hearing this stuff, so and listening to it. I don't think he has quite the attention that, like, nationally that Ish has at this point, but I think the potential is just as much there as it is with Ish and with Robbie in many different ways, because they have, I think, a very different style and a different delivery with their vocals. Yeah. And I think that's what makes Robbie so unique in that aspect. And
what's
I love
crazy,
the,
sorry, I'm so sorry to cut you off. What's ridiculous is I also know that Robbie and Ish have something in the vault together.
Ooh.
Robbie and Ish, and I'm just gonna leave it at that. He tweeted about it too, but I'm gonna leave it at that. And it's tough. It's an amazing combination and like tag team from some of the, you know, most, I think, promising artists we got out here. But carry on.
For sure. And I'll definitely agree to your point as well. I love the dancehall reggaeton sounding beat. Almost very tropical sounding and atmospheric.
But yeah.
It has like still rooted in like almost like a lo-fi, you know, vibe to it. And I really love the aesthetic. And I think I agree with you perfectly. I think that drowned out SZA vocal sample, where if you really listen close, you can hear it. It's, you might not on the first listen, but if you really listen closely, like a couple listens, it'll start to, I think, push itself a little bit to the forefront. And enough that like it actually adds something, right? It's not like really deeply embedded here. So I think Jonas did a nice job with the mix on that. And now having heard the full album, I will say this, I don't think this is actually my favorite song, which actually would be a testament to the project as a whole, that this isn't even my favorite song from the project. So I really urge people to go check out the project. It's 10 songs. I believe it's barely a half an hour, 29 minutes. So the runtime is there, like, you know, in terms of accessibility, it's not super long. It's not going to drag you down. It's going to definitely leave you wanting more, for sure.
Definitely.
Probably my favorite song on that's Too Long, but, you know, I definitely want to, you know, people
too
to
long,
check
too
it.
Too Long is great. Yo, so even good. The intro, man. Off
Oh, the intro is great, too.
I love the Everything. Intro. It's great.
I love this. Yeah, the project itself is really good. But back to All My Life, of course. You know, it's got a nice, relaxing vibe to it, but I definitely, and his delivery as well, this is, I think, a moment where I'm going to almost be contradictory here. I think his more laid-back delivery actually works super well on a song like this, because, you know, it's almost like he's flowing so well, but it's almost like he's whispering it. You know what I mean? So you have to, like, his delivery is whisper. So you really have to, like, really hear it, but it doesn't come off as very aggressive or anything like that. And of course, I just really enjoy as well, like, a lot of like the lyricism here, where he's talking about people kind of doubting him and like his come up, trying to prove people wrong, and wanting this for his whole life and things like that. I love the line where he says, "When the grass looked greener, you was on the other side, and I never picked
when the
sides."
The grass looked greener, you was on the other side.
But I never picked sides.
Never picked sides. Like, yeah. That's tough, bro.
And I will say one more thing about Jonas and his production and the way there's a couple of parts right before the hook where he has like a little bit of an instrumental break and Robbie is really pushed to the forefront in the vocals. That is what I think that was a really cool effect from Jonas, like doing that, like really pushing the beat back a little bit, like really into the background and having Robbie be more like in the bridge. More of the front and center. So I really liked the way that, and just again, not to go back to Jonas continuously, but like the testament to his way of like mixing and engineering this whole song. So I really thoroughly like this song too. I think it's only going to get more replayability from people as the summer months come along, because I think it has that type of just accessibility to the summer and the summer tones and things like that. So
no, this is summertime music for sure. It is summertime music 1,000%.
Yeah. So I highly recommend this one as well. Don't want to sound too much like a broken record, but the last three songs I think I would recommend as very much so. And this Who's Robbie Malik project, you guys definitely got to check it out. So again, linked in the description. But
yeah.
And this
also wraps up nicely. It's the you guys got to, you know, I'll stop mentioning Paper City Studios after this. These are all Paper City affiliates or artists, and I'm very, very excited for what we got going on, because I definitely think we got a lot of different people in our bag, you know what I mean? And there's a lot of different styles, so very excited, very proud of Robbie too. Like we said, continuously, go check out the rest of the album
for sure.
And shout out to him, man, because he's also worked hard to supplement like all his music with visuals and other things, and there's more visuals to come, so it's going to be just interesting and just entertaining to even watch him, you know, continue.
Definitely. And I've heard some of the stuff that's in the vault as well, and I will agree that it is really good stuff, guys. So definitely make sure you tune back in and you know, follow all these guys on Instagram, keep up with their stuff, and definitely make sure that you're tuned into upcoming releases, because there's definitely great things to come. Nice transition here. We have Chad Kroeger. I mean, Johan Lennox. if you don't
Chad
know that reference,
Kroeger.
If you don't know that reference, you didn't clearly hear the Johan Lennox episode that we just dropped a few weeks ago. You definitely got to go check that out. This man's an absolute legend, doing some incredible, incredible things. Like, I don't even want to give away too much about that episode. You guys just got to go check that out after you hear this, because
definitely this man, go check out the Johan Lennox feature interview episode. That's so hard.
So yeah, just I was amazed. Actually, walked away from that interview pretty amazed. He's a special, special human being and special talent. And he just dropped earlier in the year his lead single to his upcoming project, What Do You Want to Be When You Grow Up? This is Phases with Cousin Stiz.
Everybody's going through their phases, running through their own little mazes. I don't really mind being aimless. I don't have a plan, but I fake it. Said you might pick up and move, tryna go meet someone new. You might even go back to school. What are you trying to prove?
And of course, as I mentioned, lead single, Cousin Stiz is one of the biggest names in Massachusetts. I mean, he's up there with, you know, on the Joyner, Millie's, Michael Christmas, sort of like. He's up in that threshold, I would say. Maybe I would say out of all those guys, he might be actually like maybe a hair or two above in terms of popularity and sort of just accessibility with his stuff and the people he's worked with. But and then with Phases, particularly with this song, if you want to hear Johan get into really like crazy depth about this song, you want to hear it from the actual artist, definitely go check out that episode, because you'll definitely get the whole story behind it and everything like that. But
you got some crazy stories in there. He's seen some stuff.
He has. He's seen some stuff. He's worked with some crazy people.
Been a part
people,
of.
Like, yeah. I mean, working with Kanye West and Big Sean and just No ID. Like, he's good friends with Vic Mensa, Mike Dean. It's really, really cool stuff, man. Guys, got to go check it out. And, of course, if you like this song, which I am absolutely, like, I'll just go off the, like, I'm absolutely obsessed with this song. Like, I can't stop freaking listening to it. I love the instrumental. I think it's just the way he's able to, like, and of course, like his background's in classical composition music, so the song is just deeply textured, like very dark vibe, very dark strings and keys. He adds in some like winds as well into the mix. He even includes like nighttime like samples, even like cricket samples in the background. It's just really like the instrumental depth to this song is really amazing. And then of course he has like kind of the glue that holds it all together, are these really awesome trap drums. So and that make it very accessible as well to, I think, the mainstream and contemporary music that's coming out now. And there's even some electric guitars that get added in with Stiz's verse. So just instrumentally, this song is just a lot going on, but it's so, that was what makes it so unique. And I think for him personally, he's one of the more, and I know he has more of a classical background, he's more of a composer, but he's very underrated even as a vocalist. I think his voice is one of the most unique. When you hear him talk as well, like you hear him talk, you're like, oh my God, like this guy, it's so distinct when he speaks. And I think just overall the engineering of this whole song is just incredible. And really the, of course, and then you get into the subject matter where he's talking about like people really going through these phases, and it kind of equates to, you know, people sort of avoiding kind of growing up and taking responsibility for their lives and sort of trying to think of these arbitrary things that maybe like look cool on the surface, but really just amounts to like avoiding like and neglecting like the really important parts of their lives. Like he was even talking a little bit like how, you know, people sometimes, you know, if they think they need to kind of change their life, they, you know, they move or they go back to school or go study abroad or go abroad or travel or whatever. And he kind of has this, it's more questions than answers. He's more like, well, what are you trying to prove by doing that? And maybe the problem is you, if you're continuously doing this and you're not seeing any real results from your life changing from doing these things. So the song really just kind of, I think, forces you to like look in the mirror. And Stiz kind of has that cool contrast where he's not really thinking about any of those things. He's more like very much in tune with like the now. And I think that it's really cool having that introspective duality of somebody that grew up in suburban Massachusetts, like Winchester, Massachusetts, where Johan grew up, and then Dorchester, where Stiz grew up. So that I think with the song as well has a great sort of just juxtaposition of the two. So I am, of course, I went off on this song because I'm infatuated with it. Like easily one of my favorite songs of the year from not only Massachusetts, just in general, one of my favorite songs that I've heard this year. And This man's album, I'm telling you right now, it's going to be legendary when it comes out this summer. So huge fan of this. Go check out the episode. But Phoenix, what did you think about this song? And I know you have a little bit of a gripe with him with the whole Benny Blanco thing, with people hearing that in the very beginning of this episode. With
amen. Amen. Johan Lennox, me and him got beef. Me and Johan got beef, bro. No, I'm just kidding. Johan, well, one, I want to say, you reminded me that he's a producer as well. He made this beat, which is definitely impressive. The beat is hard as fuck. I'm just going to put it like that.
It's
Johan, you're a funny guy, too. You got a lot of personality, brother. All right? You think you got jokes, apparently.
He's got a good dry humor to him.
Right. Well, yeah. what we're referencing, me and Mike, is a comment that Johan had left on one of our videos on Instagram, saying that when he scrolls past our videos, when he sees me, he mistakes me for Benny Blanco, which is I'll leave up to the listeners and the viewers about whether they think that's an apt comparison. I personally think, you know, I'm a good looking guy, and not to say anything about Benny Blanco, but I think he would be complimented if someone said he looked like me. You know what I mean?
The people,
I don't
the people
know about
spoke.
The other way around.
The people spoke. 88% said that.
Yeah, man.
You did.
That, Mike, Mike, Instagram spoke. Polls, you know, I'm not with all the internet stuff as I make this internet podcast. I'm not with all the internet stuff. I pick and choose when I
you
like
hypocrite.
The internet. And nah. But moving on from that, the phases, I really like. The beat is amazing. The beat is so atmospheric and dark, especially in the opening. Mm. When those drums come in, you call them trap drums. I kind of have them just noted down here as definitely notably up-tempo drums. You know what I mean? As compared to, I don't know if I get like a trap feel out of them, but it's definitely faster. And I can see where, like, you know, to your point, you know, it has that, it brings in the vibe of that, the modern sounding kind of hip hop or just contemporary drums in hip hop today versus like the cool atmospheric feel and like very original and unique of the beat, like, or like you were saying, the winds and the back. It's all very dope, and definitely, I'm just going to steal what you're saying. It's a very textured instrumental, so I couldn't have put that better. And I love his delivery. I think, like, his kind of moody crooning, like, it's all... And I definitely, honestly, like, you see him, and I feel like you don't expect him to have that kind of voice.
No.
But the voice has a presence to it that I think is really, really enjoyable. And you kind of are like, you're listening to every word, I feel like, while also being able to vibe. And you know, like you said, it's kind of a melancholy song, especially with the subject matter of it and the way he's delivering it, while all kind of veiled in these in parts of these like modern sounds, because he sounds a little auto-tuney here and there, and the, like you said, the drums come in, and with the Cousin Stiz feature, I think adds definitely a good dynamic of like, we're taking this in a hip-hop direction specifically, where I think if it was just Johan, it would have been more of a hip-hop R&B-ish kind of mix. I have this noted right here, and I hate doing this, but I guess I'm gonna do it anyways, just as in terms of like a descriptor for him. He the only person that has a similar voice to him in my eyes is Saint John, and I don't know if you've heard a lot of Saint John.
He's worked with Saint John. That's one of his the plethora of artists.
Wait,
he's worked with.
That's right. No, he yeah. Note he talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't he? Yeah. So I hear that. That's funny that I'm just re-remembering that. Well, thank you for reminding me, Mike. So that's the I can hear it. In terms of a similarity, but that is not to take away from the uniqueness of what he's doing and the character that he has, because especially with the video, I don't know if you saw the video, but I also went and saw the video, and I think, you know, just with his look and the vibe, it goes together well in this very mysterious, mystique kind of way, which I think is perfect for what he was going with. And I think the cinematography or you know the visual direction taken in the video fit perfectly. And this is where, you know, we're going to run into the first speed bump for me. You know what I mean? Because I'm here. It's difficult because I'm an artist. You know what I mean? And I'm definitely, I hate people being nitpicky about my shit. And I don't mean to be nitpicky about everybody else's shit. But I'm also trying to be honest when I'm up here behind the mic and stuff. And I wasn't really impressed with Cousin Stiz's feature, which is what I had to say. And I'm not gonna lie, like I think the rap feature was a good, I think the rap feature is a good idea, but I think for me Stiz honestly didn't match the vibe quite the way that I would want a rapper to. And I, you know, you're kind of talking about where you said, you know, Johan's talking about phases and bringing up a lot of this different imagery about what things people go through. And it's when Stiz comes in, I just think he comes in, it feels like he's coming in talking about himself. And like you said, it's the present. And maybe that's an intentional artist choice, but I feel like honestly to me it came off as unrelated or not as deeply you know, connected to what Johan was talking about as much as it could have been, especially because I feel like Johan put out a distinct vibe. Like there was a
I can see that vibe.
And I can, yeah. And I like Stiz. I don't listen to him a lot, but I've always liked Stiz. And I, you know, I've heard about, like you're saying, Stiz is one of the guys from Massachusetts that has the real national recognition. So I've heard about Cousin Stiz since I was in eighth grade. You know what I mean? Hearing him rap here and there. So like, it's not like I'm not familiar with his voice either. But when he came on and when he cut on, I thought it didn't have a lot of presence, especially in the first half of it. But I think midway he kind of picks up the energy and the flows kind of change and then it gets good, which again I enjoy and I think he's really good at. Like I love Stiz's flows. I definitely think he has some wordplay and some cadences that are dope. And that's what again specifically with him made me a little bit disappointed. Because I feel like he has a dope voice. He can be melodic while also keeping it kind of gritty, too. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But like I said, it picks up midway through, and I enjoyed it. And then it felt like it trailed off at the end again. Like, it even felt, even in terms of, like, his vocal delivery, like, it got a little bit softer. And I don't know. And, again, this is all personal preference and opinion. But all of it, all in all, didn't take away from the enjoyability of the track. Honestly, I really liked it. And I don't know if you peeped, there's like one ad lib or like one set of background vocals for like a second that has like this little prismizer sounding kind of thing at the end, which I thought was really, really dope. And like I said, the music video is dope and I liked his vibe. And I think visually Stiz looked dope on the video and brought the same kind of energy. So all in all, definitely a solid track for me.
Yeah, yeah. And listen, I actually understand your point with Stiz. I for sure, out of the two of them, think that Johan stole the show. And I don't think Stiz really took away from Johan. I don't think he also, like, triumphed him in terms of, like, their, you know, their parts. But I thought maybe I liked the Stiz feature a little bit better than you just because I thought it was a little bit more of a change of pace from what Johan was doing. So I liked, and then I also liked the fact that he was talking more about himself, actually, believe it or not, because I think Stiz was sort of going like against what Johan was saying, right? Because Johan's more talking about how, like, all these, everyone's like trying to go through all these phases, and Stiz is like, I'm not, man. Like, I'm just doing my thing. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I actually thought that the way in which he sort of commented upon Johan, even though it was very different, it still kind of was, there was still a link there, or there was at least a cohesiveness somewhat. But I do from a perspective of that, like seeing, like, I don't think it was the strongest Stiz verse I'd ever heard or anything like that. So I will say that. But I certainly do agree with the fact that Johan, like, I prefer Johan over Stiz, like, on this specific song, like, no question about it. I thought Johan just did his thing 1,000%. Like,
yeah, and it wasn't to pin them against each other. I think just when you have such an amazing performance by Johan, obviously anybody who's featured on that, you want to feel the same thing, It doesn't have to be more, but you want it to at least be relatively equal in terms of the enjoyability of both of the verses.
Yeah, but either way, I mean, I think we both clearly enjoy it. It's a great song. Obviously, let us know in the comments what you think. Obviously, the song is linked in the description, so make sure you check it out. And be on the lookout for his album. It's coming soon. This summer, he's going to probably come back on as well and do an album analysis episode for that. So I am, like, so excited for that. And just big shout out to him, honestly, for his just time and transparency and his support of our show and what we're doing. So I really appreciated his time and everything that he's doing and putting on for Massachusetts. He wants to work with more Massachusetts people as well. Like, he was talking a lot about that, like how much he appreciates when he hears, you know, Massachusetts artists doing their things. So, you know, really big shout out to him. And obviously go stream that that guest speaker episode that came out about 2 weeks ago.
And he's got jokes, man. He's got jokes. Yeah. And he's now, got a good now dry even humor. In my circle, people are calling me Benny Blanco.
Robbie Malik was...
Curse you, Johan.
Robbie Malik was even saying, he's like, now I can't unsee it or something like that. I was crying.
Nah, people have been calling me Blanco.
Now they're going to get you confused with Millie's because Millie's is Blanco.
right, dude. Yo, crazy. Hey, I'm Phoenix. I'm Phoenix.
I'm Phoenix Rios. So the next song we have here is a Turntable Teachers affiliate and someone I've known for a very, very long time. This is my man Beliefs, and he is a North Shore, Massachusetts producer, specifically from Danvers, where I grew up. And he was our very first guest speaker of all time on this podcast. And he joined us as well for he's doing Beats with Beliefs. He was doing some beat tutorials with us, and those are both those two episodes are also out now if you're interested in being a producer yourself. And Beliefs is somebody that is very rooted in old school hip hop. If you check out his one of his projects from a couple years ago, specifically, it's called The Horizon. He's got some really great guests as well, like well-known names too. Like if you're a hip hop head, you'll enjoy that. Got artists like Raekwon on there and Millie's, like who we've mentioned before.
Oh, he's, word. Yeah,
this shit's fire. Like I'm telling you right now, it's really good. He's he's got Elzai on there. He's got Styles P on there. There's a lot of
shit
on cue, Michael Christmas. So he's got a great variety of like national, like very, like,
oh, I'm going to have to go listen to more.
It's yeah. So that album specifically is very different from the vibe of this track that we're talking about today, and which is Intentions featuring Shotty G and Alma Cook. I've been holding you and all I become all I will be. Putting hearts and all aside. I'm waiting for everyone. I've been throwing it aside with the best intention for things. Trying to find someone fitting for your hat throw. I've been waiting, but see now you can take it. Where is from me? Now you wanna claim you've been here from the start. See, I ain't working this hard for you to take this all off from me. Now you want me, baby. Shotty G is a Swedish vocalist, and Alma Cook is a Midwestern vocalist from Wisconsin. So, and the reason why I was the one that picked this song in particular, of course, given that I'm familiar with him and good friends with him, but I also picked this song as well because this was part of a four-pack that he put out a couple of weeks ago, and he had another song with Caskey and Teddy Andreas, which is a little bit more hip-hop and old school, a big boom bap inspired. But I wanted to bring this one in because the vibe is very unique and different from a lot of the other songs like that we have on the listing. So I wanted to get some variety in here. So and I personally, because I just really like the track as well, have a few critiques of it, but I definitely enjoy the song. But I would love to hear first from you what you think of this song, because of course, like, I don't just obviously tidbit, as you guys know, like we've said this before on other song reviews, like Phoenix and I don't talk about how we feel about these songs beforehand. Like, this is all like, I don't know how he feels, he doesn't know how I feel,
right?
So definitely want to hear your thoughts.
Live.
Yes, this is live. So we definitely
live reactions. But so Beliefs, Intentions featuring Shotty G and Alma Cook. I'm not gonna lie, I'm looking forward more to hear Mike's piece on it. Because in all reality, I didn't walk away with a lot to say about it. And again, this is with all respect. And clearly music is subjective. This could be somebody's favorite song and I wouldn't hold that against you. But I really, you know, I liked the breathy vocals from Shoddy G and Alma Cook. So they're both on it. Mm-hmm. To be honest, I had some problems distinguishing one from them. The other.
Yeah.
Yeah, you too. Okay, so I'm not alone on that.
At first, I did.
And that was kind of difficult for me, but I think overall, also, I had a little bit of problems understanding what the lyrics specifically were, but I didn't think that this was also, in my opinion, and maybe I didn't hear it, you know, so that's why, again, I'm interested in what Mike's breakdown is going to be, because I know he's going to pick up all of the details, but I didn't grasp what the concept of the song was completely, and although I didn't feel like that was 100% needed, because I do think a lot of this is like the vocal performance, like they have these cool whispery breathy vocals and a lot of cool falsettos, for sure, some beautiful falsetto like runs and stuff that was definitely very, very enjoyable. And there's a real soul-y kind of thing. It reminded me of kind of old SZA. Like, I don't know if you listen to SZA before Control. She has a very, very darker, more breathy kind of delivery. And that's what I got the vibes from this. And it was definitely a vibe. The beat for me was the star of the show, for sure. I thought I love the jazzy kind of instrumentation there, but also with some like real, real spacey R&B melody in the background. And I thought it was dope. I thought it was dope. It didn't give me, like I said, when you can't understand exactly what the vocalists are saying, it doesn't give you a large feeling, or it doesn't leave me with like a big concept to kind of hold on to behind the song. But, you know, the performances and for what they were doing in terms of vocals, I thought they did that solid. And I also felt like it was coherently dark and like moody throughout the whole thing, which I also enjoyed. But like I said, I want to know, is there something I'm not catching, Mike?
No, I think you had more to say about it than I thought you originally did. You said you didn't have a lot to say. I think you said quite a bit. But so in terms of the subject matter, I kind of see your point. It took me a lot of listens to really understand what Shoddy was saying, because when I distinguish the two, Shoddy has that first verse, and Alma really just kind of adds a lot of vocals within the hook, and they have like a little bit of a back and forth. You can tell Shoddy's vocals are very, like, not drowned out or anything like that, but you can tell that they're a little bit distorted. And I don't know if that's her accent or if it was the actual, like, distortion on the actual, like, effect of her vocals in general. So I'm not 100% sure where that lies. I don't disagree that at first I was having a hard time with the just, like, understanding what they were saying. But what I took away from this song, especially in the hook, was that the song was more about just kind of navigating people that don't have good intentions for you. And also on the opposite, if people do have good intentions for you, it doesn't necessarily mean that the relationship is going to work out. Like, there's that concept of like, oh, well, like this person, you know, does have good intentions for me and they do care about me. And that's all good and well, but that doesn't necessarily indicate that the relationship's gonna, like, you know, be a beneficial one, or like a one that is mutually beneficial. So that was really like the meat and potatoes of like, or healthy, exactly. That's a great way to describe it too. But in terms of that, like, that's where I kind of got the subject matter. But I hearing you say that, I don't disagree that the concept isn't exactly fleshed out. And I think the runtime of the song has something to do with that. It's not super long song. It's maybe like a little over 2 minutes. So it's not like, you know, they both don't have, like, you know, very, like, well thought out, like, verses. I think, but for me personally, I agree with your sentiment, though, that I don't think that was even really 100% the point, because I actually really like just the aesthetic in general. That's why I really enjoy that piece of it. And I think this is a setting song. I don't think this is a song that you can go play, like, you know, with like a group of people, or it's a song where like you're gonna like play it at like a party or like a, you know, a gathering or whatever the case, and like you're going to like that people will tune in and enjoy it. I think it's much more of a like very late night driving type song, or like introspective, like in your, like just in your sort of space with this, right? Like, yeah, very late night. That's
in your room with the Christmas lights on, maybe some incense going.
Yeah. I mean, I have actually a really cool thing. It's like, I don't even know what you would call it, but it's like this light where it like shines and it makes it almost like looks like space and shit like that. It's like there's like
projector lights.
Yeah, like a projector, like a starlight projector or whatever. So like this would be a song where I would like throw on the projector light and like just vibe out to this song, because I love just the groovy.
Mike just throws on the projector lights, you know what I mean? Dusts the mood, off the vinyl. You know?
Exactly, right? Yeah, you dust the, exactly. That's perfect imagery there. But yeah, I love the hi-hats and the drums. They have like a boom bap sound, because that's kind of has Beliefs' signature written all over it with that. And I love the funky sax sample, because I'm a sucker for saxophones. So like that's part of it. And I think the xylophone and sample on it as well really gives it like a very distinct vibe as well, or a distinct mood, because it's a lot brighter than the rest of like everything else. So it's very much, I think it just contrasts very well. So, and the one thing I will say about Shoddy G is it's interesting because they both, sometimes is a little bit hard at first to distinct them. But once you do distinguish the two of them, Shoddy G has a very like high, like uniquely high vocal cadence. And I like how it actually fit the instrumental in the way that like Beliefs utilizes that like breathy reverb on her voice. You had mentioned that as well. And Alma Cook's vocals feel a lot more strong than like strong sounding than Shoddy. Shoddy has more of, I think, like a light, really sort of touching sort of delivery. So that's, I actually was able to distinguish them. It's that stuck out to me more with like repeated listens. So I think this is a song where your setting matters, and I think it'll hit it a different way depending upon that. So that's the only critique I have of the song. And of course, and I agree with some of your critiques as well. And it's interesting because Beliefs oftentimes doesn't do a lot of songs like this. There's a couple on the horizon that are a little bit similar-ish, but I don't think he's ever gone completely this direction as he has with this. So I love that he took a step outside of his comfort zone and a box to give us something like this that's a little bit more different than what he's done in the past.
Yeah,
so,
definitely. I mean, you're saying he got stuff with Raekwon, Styles P, you know,
M-Dot.
I mean? Like, right, that's definitely a complete 180 from what this sounds like. So
yeah,
if this is, you know, like in the scope of like his discography, if I'm going off of somebody that's producing for someone like a Raekwon or a Styles P, this is definitely a departure from that. So
for sure. So I think even a little bit too, it speaks to, you know, again, like I said, his ability to jump outside his comfort zone and try something a little bit different. So I thought it was executed pretty well for the most part, and it's a song that I've been dabbling back and forth with a lot. So I definitely wanted to hear your thoughts. And you had even said, you know, because we did a lot of the national stuff in our last singles review, and you were mentioning that you, again, I was actually expecting that you weren't going to like this song, so actually glad that you found some things to kind of pull away from it that you like. And because remember we were talking last time, you were saying like, you know, even though I don't like it, I want you to encourage me to give me more stuff that's out of my comfort zone and out of my taste, because it gives just more of a, you know, just an overall. So again, I wanted to diversify it as well. So this is, again,
definitely.
I like what Beliefs did.
This is definitely in the like the pocket of the kind of stuff like when I'm trying to experiment with what I'm listening to. This is definitely something I go to. Like, this is a dark, moody, jazzy hip hop R&B kind of thing. Like I said, comparing it to an old SZA kind of vibe, which I loved a lot. And you know, I think you did put that really well. I think I've kind of gone through this three listens where I was definitely present for all of them and you know, actively listening. But maybe I wasn't necessarily and honestly wasn't nighttime, you know what I mean? I think this would definitely hit nighttime by myself. I'm rolling up a little something to end the night real quick, you know what I mean? And Mike's hitting me about recording on a podcast. I decline, and because I'm having me time, You know, and I could see that definitely playing in to how I would consume this, and would probably make it a lot better. And like I said, I'm gonna go back to Beliefs, especially because you was naming a whole bunch of MCs that I'm into. So shout out to Beliefs, man.
It's legit. So again, this song is also linked in the description. Go make sure you check out The Horizon as well. It's his full length project that he dropped about 2 years ago. About 2.5 years ago now, but. Just really awesome stuff from him. So definitely want to go check that one out. And moving on, we have two songs left in this episode. And this upcoming one is another Turntable Teachers alumni. This is Dev Soder with one of his latest songs off of his brand new EP that's called The Ditta Tapes. I also highly recommend that. And this song is called Brainless. Soder's Brainless track from The Ditta Tapes.
Yo, Dev Soder, shout out to you. Just followed me back on Instagram too. Not gonna lie, that made my day. Cause I got put on to Dev Soder through your last year's the cumulative list of like the best songs from Massachusetts that you put out. Yep. That's when I caught wind of Dev Soder from Mike. And what was the song that you had on that list?
That was Hills, which is also on the Ditta Tapes. So that was the lead single for the Ditta Tapes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Hills I enjoyed very, very much. I think so Dev has a specific sound. He has a specific voice. And I think, you know, it's people like, you know, Dev Soder that like, one, also remind me that like hip hop has such a large influence in how people make music today, even with people who have what I can tell from Dev, especially after listening to Brainless, he clearly has a palette that's not hip hop exclusively.
You know what I mean? Definitely not. No way.
But on Hills, he was kind of rapping. On Hills, he was kind of rapping and getting into some cool, moody, like introspective stuff. So like I really enjoyed Hills. And then there was a problem on streaming services where Hills was unavailable for me, but I think that has been remedied since. But so when I saw this on the list, I was definitely looking forward to it. First thing I saw was the cover art. I thought the cover art was really cool, a little like almost like he looks like he's at a beach or in some sunny day with some T-shirt over him. I don't know. It just looked cool. It fits his aesthetic, you know. And I think what I also like about Dev Soder is the aesthetic. Like, he just seems like a chill, laid-back dude that I would, like, call up and be like, bro, like, I don't know, want to go burn and just, like, drive off in, like, a 70s, like, mystery van-looking thing. I don't know. Like, maybe I'm going off the rails. But with this one, like, I like this, because this gave me, like, a beach, almost like a beach hip-hop kind of, like, not beach rock. And I don't even know if I know exactly what beach rock sounds like. But, like, this gave me, like, a
maybe
beachy.
This.
Yeah, this gave me, like, a beachy hip-hop, funky but poppy. And I saw that it was actually, he categorized it as a pop single, like, in the genre. But it's definitely hip-hoppy in there. You know what I mean? And just in terms of the way he flows. Right? Right? Yeah, so in terms of like the way he's flowing in there, not just like the songwriting, but as a vocalist himself, he definitely goes, he definitely has a wide range on this song.
Yeah.
Even though it's so short.
Packed so much into that, like, 2 minutes.
Yeah, he did. He really brought me to, like, a couple different places with such a short song. I got some lyrics written down here. I really like, you know, kind of he reiterates, like, your friends really hate me. Who would have thought? You know what I mean? I like a lot of those. He has a couple lines where it's, you know, like, I'm here or something's happened and who would have thought? And it's kind of like, he almost kind of says it like tongue in cheek, you know? It's like, And that's where I get this really laid back, nonchalant, like, yo, this guy is emotional, but is keeping it cool, man. Like, he keeps cool it cat. Cool, which I liked a lot. I got another line. I've been chasing something that's faceless. That's part of the hook. I really, really liked that bar. I won't give you a dime. All I have is time, and you waste it.
I wrote that one down, too.
That's a bar.
That's
a bar. I won't give you a dime because all I have is time and you waste it. Again, it's like insightful, like or profound kind of things. And again, we talked about how he jumps from kind of flows. It sounds hip hoppy, but this is where it just sounds straight like songwriter, you know. And it's kind of like it's almost kind of hidden by like how cool his vocal melodies are.
Yeah,
and totally. That's what I love. You know, I love when the sonics and just the sounds on the surface of an artist is captivating, and then when you start to pay attention to the lyrics, they just add to that. So I really enjoyed this, and like I said, he also has a real cool falsetto kind of delivery on the first half of the hook. Like we said, there's some range in this 1:50 song, you know what I mean? And it's like, but it's also catchy enough because it does have a hook that repeats. And I at the end of it was like, damn, it's over. You know what I mean? I wanted some more. So yeah. And that's always a good thing, right? You want to leave them wanting more. So I guess he
accomplished that.
Yeah, accomplished that 1,000%. Mm-hmm. And honestly, it was so short that it repeated on my laptop when I was playing it through today for the last time. And I just like, it just looped nicely. And I was like, yeah, I will listen to this for another 2 minutes. Like what's that?
You got me, Dev.
Tops. Yeah, like, I'm so, it was a really solid listen. And like I said, man, I'm not trying to say this is clouding my view, but he followed me back on Instagram. So clearly he's a solid guy with an eye for good content. And like I said, you put me on, Mike. So shout out to you. And how do you feel about Brainless?
So I loved Hills, of course. It was my number 14 song. I think 14 or 13, one of those two. It was I was the middle of the teens on my top 20 Massachusetts songs from last year. And Hills was the lead single for Did It Tapes. And I think Brainless is actually the second single. And the Did It Tapes, for anybody that hasn't heard it yet and also heard the guest speaker episode that we did with Dev, that was only maybe like a month ago, if that. So definitely go check that out. I love this song though, man. Like, this is Hills is probably my favorite still from that Did It Tapes, but like Brainless is either like a close second, or there's even a song on there that's called Too Fast. It's really, really good too. I just love the psychedelic, like funky nature of this song, like the cool guitars and the bass at the forefront, just the overall personality of it. And I agree with a lot of the sentiments you had too. You covered quite a bit that I was gonna say, like, I love his vocal range, the high falsettos, the deeper like emotional notes that he hits, like the lower tones. And he even, like, what I gotta get from, like, aesthetically and like or sonically I should say, like, I get he's very much like into really like that Brockhampton bag, that Dominic Fike bag, you know, if you will, like those types of artists. Or even so much as to say, go as far, like, if you hear certain songs from Andre 3000, Speaker Love Below, excuse me, I even think there's a little bit of that, too, like with the funk.
High praise from Mike Scarfo. You get now, the Outkast comparison. That's high praise right there.
Just in terms of influence, Dev, I'm sorry. I know Dev's going to be definitely listening to this because he's very much a friend of the show. I'm not saying you're Andre 3000, so just, let's just get that situated. No one is Andre 3000 in my book.
Yeah, and
okay?
That's not even a chance. Nothing you can argue with.
There's nothing you can do about
Andre.
That. There's nobody's Andre. But I'm saying in terms of the influence, I can kind of hear, or not even influence, maybe, like maybe because he wasn't influenced by that potentially. Like, I have no idea.
But it's like a wide palette. I can hear that. Like someone like Andre who's not afraid to play with their vocals and still sound hip hoppy. I hear that.
Yeah, so I'm just more like, yeah, exactly. I'm more making the comparison of what he did on Love Below is a little bit similar to what Dev's doing here with this project in particular with a song like Brainless. And I just, again, I love the effects of like his vocals on this whole song. And it's like you said, it's just a song you kind of get lost in. And even if it loops back, you almost don't recognize that it restarted because it loops back right. So perfectly. And the EP plays really well to that aesthetic as well. And yeah, like subject wise, I really enjoy it too. Like feeling as if he like doesn't amount to who this girl like thinks that he should be, or maybe she wants him to be. That my favorite line as well. You already said it, but I won't give you a dime. All I have is time, and you waste it. Like, oh, just how relatable Ooh. Is that? You know what I mean?
Ooh. It's like a lot of that goes in line with like your friends really hate me. Who it's like. You know, it
Who would have thought we got here?
It's kind of a look. I'm like, yeah, I feel like we're all moving brainless out here. It's like a lot of stuff doesn't make sense, and maybe I'm not the best, but you're also not the best person either.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Oh, isn't it one of my favorite things? I shouldn't say favorite things, but one of the really great things about when you're kind of rocky in a relationship or whatever. Like, you know, let's say like looking back, if it's a relationship that's past. You know, you're not going to obviously love everyone's, like, you know, all the friends of your significant other or, like, people. It's just the kind of that. I mean, it's very rare, I think, that happens. But, you know, of course.
Oftentimes it goes the other way around.
Exactly. But also, like, when you're in that relationship, you got to, like, you got to be nice. You got to be kind. You got to be polite. You got to kind of play that role. And then once it starts to, like, completely go south and, like, you know, maybe he or she's criticizing you or whatever, you're just like, you know what, like. Maybe he or she says, oh, like my friends didn't like you. Well, you know what? I didn't like your friends either.
They
ain't gonna be my friends now. You know what I mean? So I love that.
Or it's oh, go figure. Your friends don't like me. It's like, no, they don't. They only know one side of me from what you've told them.
That's true too. Exactly. So I think all that really just, I think the interpretation piece, like you can see it both ways or either way, depending upon like the experiences that you've had. And as a person, so yeah, I just think it's relatable, it's accessible. I love the funk, the groove to it, and just like, of course, like you said, there's a piece of hip hop in it, but it's really beyond that. I mean, it's mm-hmm. I wouldn't really categorize him hip hop. I know Hills has more of like more rapping than singing.
Hills, he's definitely rapping a little bit.
Yeah. He's got the flow going, but the other songs for sure in his catalog definitely speak to more of a pop, psychedelic funk even, or like smooth R&B. He's a big fan of like a guy like Dominic Fike and Brockhampton, things like that. So like the influence is there. Like I hear that. But you know, I think he's doing a very putting a proprietary spin on it on his own too. So I'm glad you like the song as much as you did. Again, I'm glad that you are into a song that is a little bit more outside of what you normally would maybe listen to. So that's really sweet.
Yeah, man, something that's not boom bap lyrics over your head.
Exactly.
Nah, sometimes you need something else, man. Sometimes mm-hmm. you need something different, man.
Exactly. And speaking of something different, we got our final song here in this episode. And I'm really curious to hear what you have to say about this one. But this is Sleeping Bella with Insatiable. Insatiable, that dropped of the same name not too long ago. Phoenix, I'm gonna hold my breath here. I know you didn't really care for Intentions because I know the vibe is a little similar. Not really. Like I would say there's definitely a lot of differences between this song and a song like Intentions with Beliefs. But what'd you think of Insatiable by Sleeping Bella?
Hey man, I'm honestly gonna break a rule right here. Of like what a good co-host should do, and I'm gonna throw it back to you.
Ooh.
I don't want to start this one,
okay?
Especially going off of how I started Intentions. I'm gonna actually let you go first, and then
I like it.
And then you can react Or I'll react to what you say. Sounds good. You will have Sounds that good. Back and forth.
I like that. Okay, so Sleeping Bella, I've been a fan of hers for a little while. She's worked with an artist like Mako, who we're obviously a fan of. Spoiler alert, like Mako's song might be on the next episode, for sure will be on the next episode. But and of course, her song, his song with her, Lifelike, actually as well made my top 10, or even top 20, I should say, from last year as well. So I've been a huge fan of Sleeping Bella. I really like this song, bro. I freaking love it. I this is a song where, like, similar situation with Intentions, where, like, late at night, dude, like, you know, I think it fits really well in the background, as like by yourself and whatever. But I also feel like it has such a very dark, deep sort of vibe to it. I even so much I want to say too, this is probably the darkest sounding song she's ever put out. Very much more of like a synth pop type of song for sure. I think it's very meditative. There's also even a little bit.
Definitely a lot of synths in there.
A lot of synths. A little bit even entrancing as well. You know, even though this is definitely like, it has Sleeping Bella's sort of hand on it, I can definitely hear how this is definitely much different than what she's put out in the past. Definitely a lot darker, as I mentioned. So really, you know, credit to her for reinventing her sound a little bit on this one. The synths are very much in your face on this one, as you just pointed out. But then her vocals and reverb on the hook, I think, are really pushed to the forefront in the mix. I think it's amazingly gorgeous. I love her vocals on this. And I think her vocal performance is probably my favorite part of the song as a whole. And I think if you're someone that doesn't know Sleeping Bella, is not familiar with her, but this is the best way I could put it. Like, I'm not saying that she sounds, again, it's kind of similar to what I said about with Dev Soder. Like, I'm not saying she sounds like any of these artists or that she is any of these artists or anything like that. But if you like The Weeknd, Halsey, FKA Twigs, like if I could like take those three and kind of mix them all together, I think that that's like kind of what it ends up kind of sounding like at the end of the day. And I think if you like any of those artists, I think this is a song that'd be pretty accessible for you, that it would fit well in like a playlist with those artists. I think you could put it in a playlist with those artists and it wouldn't necessarily like feel out of place or skip a beat. So right. I love this song. I love the vibe. I love the aesthetic. I think it's, again, it's dark, but it's also really, I think she really contrasts it well and juxtaposes it well with her vocals. I think she's a beautiful vocalist just in general. Very breathy, very, you know, in a lot of ways. So I love this a lot. Really big fan. And I'm nervous though, because you put it back on me. So what do you think of Sleeping Bella, Insatiable?
Okay, well, there's no reason to be nervous. The track is solid.
Oh,
the track is solid. Okay. You know, I think I have some gripes with it. I'll start with like what I like. I think the I'll start with what I didn't like. And I don't even want to say that. That's a little bit too frank. It's like, it's not even necessarily like what I didn't like. That's for like a lack of a better term. It's just critiques that I had. It runs for 44 minutes and 46 seconds.
It's
a long track.
It is a little long.
It's 5 minutes and it has a slow build up and kind of a slow resolution. So I think like there could have been some space chopped up on both ends just to make it like, even when you just look at the runtime before you press play on your phone or on YouTube, it's a little daunting. And I think it also, again, this is a part of my critiques, I think kind of overstays its welcome a little bit. I think I kind of got the point of it after a while, and that's one critique. And
I can see that part.
And that's probably actually really my only critique, is that I felt like it dragged out. And there was parts of it, like I said, especially towards the end of the song, where the lyrics weren't necessarily really doing it for me. And at that point, I had already gotten like a good dose of how great of a vocalist she is. That the song was just a little long and it lost my attention. And the only reason, you know, I'm only giving this one to be honest about my reaction, you know, but also this can maybe be some constructive criticism. And I do think it takes away from a track when you have certain parts of the song where you're like, I just tune out at that point, you know.
Yeah.
But kind of what we've talked about before is setting definitely plays a part into the perception of music and the enjoyability of it. And maybe this could definitely, not maybe, but this definitely has some nice ambiance to it and something I could have in the background. So going to what I do like about it, tons of cool, dark, ominous synths, kind of like you said. I think the delays and the reverbs also sound like very crisp and like clear and clean, and they add the effect that I think they're like, the intended effect was accomplished, you know what I mean? So I think she got that, or the team that also was behind the mixing and engineering got that. And Sleeping Bella herself definitely has very, very, very beautiful vocals. And I'm not unfamiliar with her, because you've spoke about her. You've also put her on a couple of your lists. So I have heard her before, and I've always come away with, I haven't personally listened to a lot of her music, but I've always come away with like, damn, that girl can sing. Right here I have written down very, very beautiful vocals, very angelic kind of sound to her, because it's that soft, like, and it kind of plays into that aesthetic of Sleeping Bella. It's kind of this sleepy, soft, moans from like what feels like could be from the heavens above, or from like some souls from very, 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 very deep below beneath the earth's core. Like, it, you know what I mean? It has that almost otherworldly kind of vocals. This is not just for me, like, you know, kissing ass to make up for what I'm saying before. Like,
no,
she really delivered this really well. And I like that a lot. And then I, for some reason, I don't know why, Insatiable, I thought was a really cool word for a track, and then I saw that she had the whole project out. And I just Googled the word insatiable, to double check I knew what it meant, right? and I had a feeling, I knew that it was a kind of like an appetite you can never really satisfy. Mm-hmm. But then I saw that there's a movie, I don't know if you know this, Mike, there's a movie called Insatiable that actually is starring Debbie Ryan from Jesse, that Disney show. I don't know if you ever heard of that, but it's an old Disney show, Jesse, that has Debbie Ryan in it. And this movie, Insatiable, has her starring in it. And it's about this, which I thought with like the cover art that she has on YouTube with it, and kind of the aesthetic she has of, like, she looks like this, you know, Sleeping Bella, Sleeping Beauty, Bella, like, kind of this dark Disney princess kind of vibe. So when I saw that Insatiable came up as this movie that's a dark comedy about a girl who wants to be a pageant contestant, like, she wants to be a beauty pageant contestant, but it like, eventually, like, leads to her, you know, going through some unhealthy mental things of trying to, as I'm assuming anybody who's participated in beauty pageants struggle with. And like I said, I don't know if this is directly related or intentional, but it felt like it worked. Insatiable, the movie. So I'll, because I don't know if it's related necessarily, I'll move on kind of quickly, but it had to do with, you know, somebody who was, this is just somebody's looking for beauty, or is pursuing, or has this desire to feel beautiful, but is constantly in, you know, kind of facing, just struggling with their perception of themselves, which I thought fit kind of also the theme of the song. You know what I mean? Where there's things to be desired, and or there's a certain appetite for how you want to feel, how you want to look, and move throughout the world, but you can't quite always get it. Or there's a certain reaction you want from a significant other, but their appetite or what they desire from you is insatiable, and like, maybe it's just unachievable. Or you have this appetite for someone else that you are so hooked that you desire them at all times, that your appetite for them is insatiable. So that's you know, me flexing that I know what the word insatiable means, but also
use it in context.
I thought it tied in well again. So I don't know if that's intentional by her with the whole Debbie Ryan movie thing, but the song was beautiful. I thought it ran a little long. I didn't particularly come away with anything besides kind of plays on, in terms of like the songwriting, besides kind of plays on having an insatiable kind of appetite or desire for something or someone. So that, I would have liked a little bit more from the songwriting of it all, but again, maybe I didn't catch it. And yeah, but I do have a line written down here. Is it wrong to be sad when once there was a deadly sin that spiraled out into the wind? And I thought, you know, I don't even necessarily know what that means, but damn, it's beautiful. It's like, yeah, I don't know, but yeah, that's kind of almost the vibe I was getting throughout the whole song. I wasn't completely understanding where we were going with it, and then with how long it was, I felt like, all right, we could wrap this up a little bit soon, but damn, throughout the whole thing, it was like beautiful and almost like ominously beautiful.
I think in a lot of ways, the fact that you said otherworldly, I think that's a great way to describe it. I think you described it actually very well. Now looking at it, it maybe is a little bit long. I don't disagree. Especially, it's funny you say that though, because like I think that's, it's only long for today. You know what I mean? Because there were many 4 to 5 minute songs that came out 10, 15, 20, 30 years ago.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. And I mean, there was 8-9 minute tracks coming out from early hip hop. Like,
1,000%.
People just went forever.
1,000%. And I will say this, there is a part of it that even though it's a little more angelic in the hook and the chorus than it is throughout the rest, there is a little bit of I'll almost go in the sense of like, what I said a little bit about Jonas's motivation. My one critique of that song was a little bit tonal. So I do see that as being a little bit tonal. Maybe there would have been maybe a more dynamic part to the song that would have maybe broken up that 4.5 minutes. Or maybe if it had been 2.5 to 3, then there's really not an issue here. And I think similarly with something like what Dev Soder did with Brainless, that's 2 minutes and you're like, you're begging you for more. It's almost that weird dichotomy where it's like, you would almost prefer it to be 2 minutes so that way you're begging for more versus like 4.5 minutes. You're getting a little bit, not bored, but just like you're getting a little bit.
Yeah, you want to leave on a high note though versus kind of leaving on, not bored, but it almost gets a little convoluted towards the end if we've run the song out, you know, for a while.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
No, it does. It does. But overall, man, I think what Bella is able to accomplish on this song is just, I think it's gorgeous. I'm so like enamored with her as an artist and her sound. So I this is something that I definitely like. Put it this way, for me, the 4.5 minutes doesn't bother me. I can see how it could bother others. And like, especially if this isn't like a genre that you like listen to all the time or love, like, you know, how I mentioned, you know, that I feel it's like, you know, people that like The Weeknd, Halsey, and FKA Twigs, like if you liked any of those artists, I'm not saying she sounds like any of them, but like if you like any of those artists, you know, sonically,
this is definitely in your ballpark.
It would be in your ballpark. And I love those three artists. So that's maybe why I gravitate towards it a little bit more. But overall, like, you know, judging, you know, all of it just encompassing, I think you said a lot of great things about it too. And I wouldn't even necessarily call those critiques or criticisms. They're more just like, I think, constructive criticisms than anything. And I think that's really the point of what you and I are doing this whole, you know, even with all these songs, whether it's we're talking about local or national music, it's, you know, one, it's constructive criticism. I never want to bash anything unless it's like 6ix9ine or something that's just freaking ridiculous. Then I'm not going to bother with that. But also though,
yo, I love that Mike just like throws the sub to 6ix9ine. Like, yo, Turntable Teachers is not with that.
We do not approve of anything that's like 6ix9ine. So we don't approve of that around here. But I will say this too. Is, again, this is all personal preference. Like, you and I, like, we have a lot of overlapping, like, genre, like taste as well in what we like. But you and I also like very different things as well in a lot of ways. So I think that's why I think you and I doing this, it's a good back and forth because, you know, you're making me see things that I don't normally see and obviously vice versa. So, like, with that, it's
definitely vice versa.
Absolutely. So I think that part is really great about it. And you know, I'll be curious to see what like other people think about not only about these songs, but like our opinions of them too. Like, where do you guys fall? And we encourage you to drop us a comment on any of these songs. what you think of them. You know, are we so off base that it's not even funny? Do you agree with us? Do you disagree with us? Or just in general, like, what would you like to say about these songs, and how much do you like them or dislike them or whatever the case? So, but, you know, all encompassing, I want to say as we kind of conclude this episode is, you know, big shout out to Massachusetts and everybody that's doing their thing and creatively, like, regardless of whether we loved or liked or disliked or whatever about your songs or whatever critiques, like, the fact that you're putting out your art for our consumption and for our criticism.
You're making something.
Exactly.
It doesn't matter. You're making something. And y'all are out there. You guys are in the arena versus just like watching. So that's always respect to the highest level.
1,000%. And honestly, like, you're impacting somebody out there. And somebody, I think, my hope is that people hear this episode and they find a new song that they really, really liked. Like, there's a song on this out of this crop that they're like, damn, this is from Massachusetts, or like, or if you're from Massachusetts, or if you're not, if you're listening to this from a completely different state, like, oh, this is what Massachusetts has to offer. Like, this is what they got going on, like, in the indie scene. Like, I hope that I encourage you to continue not only, you know, checking out our reviews, because hopefully, you know, you'll find something that you like, but also, you know, going digging through indie scenes, whether it's in your own hometown or a home state, or going out and finding out what other states and regions of the country are doing musically. I think it's, I know there's so much music out there, it's hard to, you know, cover it all or even listen to it all. But, you know, that's the hope, man. That's the goal with this. And I hope you guys enjoyed our kind of critiques, or not even critiques, I guess just our commentary, I would even say. I wouldn't even necessarily say it.
Right, yeah. You know, and right, the same way we would, it's fun for us, and this is why we do the podcast anyways, is deconstructing music. This is what's so, I love it. It's fascinating, it is. You know what I mean? And even listening to something that you think is a work in progress or has a lot of room for improvement does not mean you don't enjoy the song either. Mm-hmm. So, and we also want to be fair and honest and realistic, and the same way we would do it with some national artist who has never heard of us before is the same way we're trying to keep it real, keep it, you know what I mean? Yep. Keep it G with all the artists that we got reviewing on these podcasts today. And I gotta say, man, in episode one or part one of this, it's a pretty diverse group of songs, man. Like, the Massachusetts music scene, I think we have a very hybrid kind of style and a hybrid kind of hip-hop. And then we also have people who don't even do hip-hop at all that do their thing well. So I think this is a really good showing for Massachusetts in general in part one. And I can't wait for part two, honestly, because there are some bangers in part two.
Absolutely. And of course, if you are just like coming onto us for the first time, like as we said in the beginning of this episode, subscribe, follow us, all right, for more. And we'll be back, we'll be doing this again. And again, big shout out to the Massachusetts music scene. We want to, of course, recognize these artists and at least give them a space where they, you know, their music is being not only heard, but, you know, really, really listened to and really like dissected, because you all deserve it in your own way. And definitely, drop us a comment. Let us know what you think about these songs. And of course, if you like any of them, make sure you go follow them and support these guys and gals, because they're doing a lot of great things for the scene. And that's really it, man. And I agree with everything you said as well. I'm excited for part two. This was officially like our reboot of Massachusetts Music Review. It was formerly called Boston Artists Review, and now it is, I needed to rebrand it and reinvent, because I am not
branded, baby.
I am not perfect either. I got that critique. It's like, don't call it Boston Artist Review because not everyone's from Boston. I'm like, you're absolutely right about that. Retooling it, renaming it.
Yeah. And Western Mass is making some noise, baby. Shout out Paper City. Shout out Robbie. Shout out Ish. Shout out Jonas.
Yes, sir.
DK. You know, all of them.
The crowd. Yep. And we got more coming very soon. So, of course, follow us at Turntable Teachers and follow these guys. And thank you guys for tuning in. And we hope you enjoyed this episode. And we'll be back soon with more. And without further ado, I'm Mike.
I'm Phoenix.
We're the Turntable Teachers, and class is officially dismissed. What's going on, everyone? I'm Mike.
I'm Benny Blanco. I had to do it.